So I hope here's what you're hearing from me. I mean, we talked about so much yesterday, but to boil it down, what did I say the primary goal of our hermeneutics is? It is one word. Relationship. Yeah, the primary goal is relationship, okay? So that is quite a statement, right? So what I'm not saying is that the primary goal is, what are some alternative primary goals that some people might present? What are some alternative primary goals? Apologetics, good. Yeah, what else? Social agendas, yeah, that's good. Yeah, just to know it, like what does it say? Yeah, good. And the foundation behind that, foundational idea behind that is this book is actually revelation, right? It is actually God revealing for the purpose of making friends with us. And in that sense, we're assuming, there's an assumption there that the author can be encountered as you read his book. So what we're not trying to do is get behind the text to some historical realities that the text might talk about. What we're not trying to do is to get into the psychology and the mind even of the human author, right? What we're trying to do in it is say, how is the divine author in this text trying to either create or progress or formalize or assure relationship? Right, that's what we're saying. That's the goal of Revelation, and so that's the goal of every text of Scripture, and that should be our goal as we read. And because God has done that ultimately through the death of his Son, then we say that Christ is at the center of all of it. That was the first thing we did, was this kind of theology of Revelation and how that applies to hermeneutics. Then we went on to say that we talked about the idea of progressive revelation, right? And how progressive revelation slowly unfolds Christ, and Christ is the climax of the story, and so we should read the beginning in light of the end. We should read the beginning in light of the end, but all of that is under the heading of relationship. All that's under the heading of relationship. Here's a couple concluding points from yesterday. So here's my conclusion. In developing our hermeneutical grid, remember we talked about the grid, people go wrong oftentimes, not in their exegesis, but in their hermeneutics. The assumptions that they bring to their exegesis is where they go wrong. So in developing our hermeneutical grid, our doctrine of revelation and scripture demand our primary hermeneutical goal be relationship. In developing our hermeneutical grid, our doctrines of revelation and scripture demand that our primary hermeneutical grid be relationship. As Craig Carter said, it is a divine human encounter. In developing our hermeneutical grid, that's all we're still doing is developing the grid. We haven't even started the text yet, right? We're developing a grid still. In developing our hermeneutical grid, our doctrines of revelation and scripture demand that our primary hermeneutical goal be relational. That's what we're saying. And we looked at that from the doctrine of revelation, then doctrine of inspiration, and the doctrine of progressive revelation. That was what we did yesterday. Revelation, inspiration, progressive revelation. That was how we developed it. Okay, today, this is still a lecture under the heading of relationship, okay? The goal is relationship, but I want to think about relationship in a different way, okay? I want to think of it now, not in terms of our doctrine of revelation, inspiration, progressive revelation. I want to think of it in terms of our pneumatology. Our pneumatology. So our pneumatology is our doctrine of the Holy Spirit. In some sense, then, we are thinking of it under the category of revelation. Remember what Bavinck said. Bavinck said that the Holy Spirit testifies to us of the truthfulness of Scripture in two ways. The first is in the written text, which tells us that it is the Word of God, and the second is in illumination. And that's what we're focusing on now, the idea of the Holy Spirit's illuminating the meaning of the text to us. So with that, we're still under the heading of relationship. Relationship with God is the goal, but relationship with God is also the means. And that's, again, we're circular, right? It's the goal, but it's the means as well. Why could the Pharisees not read Scripture rightly? Not because they didn't understand their own language, right? They knew what the words on the page said, and they know Hebrew better than you and I ever will. It had nothing to do with their intellect. They had nothing to do with how well they knew the Scriptures. Maybe if they had known the Psalms a little bit better, then they would have really understood that Christ was in the Psalms. No, it had nothing to do with that. It had to do with the fact that they did not have an existing relationship with the living God who wrote the text. They couldn't see. Jesus will say that again and again to them. So God, through the Holy Spirit, we said last week, is illuminating the meaning of the text. And what's the primary thing that he's illuminating in the text? Do you remember what we said? Christ, the gospel. He's illuminating the gospel in the text to us. That's his primary work. Let's go to Ephesians 1. Once again, Paul's prayer. He prays that God would give the Ephesian believers the spirit of wisdom and revelation in knowledge of him. That's relational. That's his very first category. For the Holy Spirit, giving them revelation, illuminating to them is relational. In the knowledge of him, in knowing him. That's the goal. The goal of what the Holy Spirit is doing is giving knowledge of Christ. And he's doing it through revelation, or we could say illumination is in theological categories. And he talks about having the eyes of your heart enlightened so that you would know three things. And they all have to do with the gospel. Number one, the hope to which he has called you. Right? That's your eternal inheritance. That's the new creation. What the gospel has purchased. Number two, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints? That is, that God is a wealthy king and his wealth is in the citizens of his kingdom. And finally, the power that he is at work in us who believe. And it's the same power that he worked in Christ's own resurrection. That's what the Holy Spirit is doing. And with that, what the Holy Spirit is doing is bringing us into further understanding of what the gospel is for the purpose of relationship. The theological idea behind this is that we possess the same Holy Spirit that the authors possessed when they wrote it. The same Holy Spirit who carried holy men along as they spoke dwells within us, and he illuminates the text to us. Well, here's what that means. The Holy Spirit is essential for a right reading of Scripture. The Holy Spirit is essential for a right reading of Scripture. And in that sense, every part of our hermeneutics, once again, is relational. It's relational. We must have the Holy Spirit at work in us so that we understand the text if we are to grasp what the text is saying. So let's think for a moment about how hermeneutics, you could say, changed after Pentecost. How did hermeneutics change after Pentecost? The giving of the Holy Spirit changes the way we read Scripture. The giving of the Holy Spirit changes the way we read Scripture. The Holy Spirit intends to teach us through the text. He intends to dwell with us more experientially through the text. And he desires to illuminate the meaning of the text to us. Consider what Jesus said to the religious leaders of his day, over and over and over again. Matthew 11:15. He says this, he who has ears, let him hear. He who has ears, let him hear. This is in the context of talking about Jesus condemning the religious leaders. This is in the context of Jesus consoling, not condemning the religious leaders, but consoling the followers of John, and saying to them that John must come before him, and he concludes by saying, he who has an ear to hear, let him hear. Clearly, he's not talking about physical ears. He's talking about a spiritual ability to hear the words of Jesus, which Jesus will time and time and time again say that the religious leaders of his day do not have. Let's consider Mark 8:18, which says this, having eyes to see and ears to hear, do you not hear? And do you not remember? He says this to his disciples, right? You have to have spiritual eyes to understand the works of Jesus and to read rightly the works of Jesus. So then Luke 24:44, what Jesus must do then is open their minds to understand the scriptures. Consider Acts 16:14. One of the women, Lydia, from Thyatira, a seller of purple goods, who was a worshiper of God, the Lord opened her heart to pay attention to what Paul was saying. The Holy Spirit did a work in her heart so that she could read Scripture rightly and understand the gospel rightly in Scripture. So the Spirit then enables us to love God with our minds. He opens our ears, he opens our eyes, he gives us a new birth initially so that we can read Scripture rightly. But with that, he applies the text to our lives. He shows us, as we read, he shows us where we fall short. He shows us where we're obeying. He calls out Abba Father as we read the text. In that sense, once again, it's a divine human encounter. The Holy Spirit is interacting with us as we do read the text. And the Spirit illuminates to us Jesus in the text. Look at John 16:14. This is what the Holy Spirit will do. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The Holy Spirit's role then is to exalt Christ. That's what the Holy Spirit is always doing. He's exalting Christ. And if we look earlier, in verse 13, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. Think about that for a moment. What the Holy Spirit hears, he will speak. The Holy Spirit's listening to a conversation then, right? He hears it, and then he speaks it and declares it to us. What does the Holy Spirit hear? What conversation is he overhearing? Yeah, I think God the Father. Perhaps God the Father to God the Son. Or perhaps God the Father speaking the Logos, the Word. When God the Father speaks, he speaks the Word, which is his Son. You could say it like this. It's as if Jesus opens the curtains of heaven, and you see God the Father standing behind a pulpit. And he's preaching. And the content of what he says is God the Son. And then whatever the Holy Spirit hears, he will declare to you. You might think that's a crazy reading of the text, but that's actually Calvin's reading of this text. Calvin said that. Calvin said of this text, God the Father mounts a pulpit and he proclaims his Son. And as the Holy Spirit hears the Son proclaimed, he then declares that to those who hear. So then, what does it mean for the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth? It means he guides us into the one who is the way, the truth, and the life. The Holy Spirit's role is to exalt Christ. And he does this in the inspiration of Scripture as he carries men along, as he breathes out Scripture, and then he does it further in illumination when he shows to us that Christ is the content of Scripture. It's the Holy Spirit's ministry. It's that divine human encounter that we mentioned. And with that, the Holy Spirit is not only declaring Christ to us as we read the text, he's not only showing us where Christ is in the text, but beyond that, he gives us the faith necessary to approach God at all. Remember, Hebrews 11, verse 1. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it people of old received their commendation. And then he says this in verse 6, and without faith it's impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God, okay, if we're thinking of reading the Bible as a divine human encounter, reading the Bible is drawing near to God. So if you desire to draw near to God in the reading of Scripture, you must have faith. You must have faith. In that sense, once again, it's a circular argument, is it not? We're saying that in the reading of the text, we learn about Christ, but in order to read the text and approach God in the text, we must have faith, faith which is a gift from the Holy Spirit. Look at Ephesians 6, verse 23. Peace be to the brothers, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Where does faith come from? Faith comes from God. Right? God must give to us faith if we are to approach him. And the text itself also produces faith. So Romans 10:17, which we already heard, faith comes from hearing and hearing through the word of Christ. Right? So as we approach this text with a desire to learn from it, with a desire to receive Christ from it, the Holy Spirit is producing faith in us, but he also must produce faith in us if we're to approach it rightly. It's this interesting cyclical thing that at the end of the day leaves us saying, I need the Holy Spirit. I need him to work. I need him to do something that I can't do myself. But he also gives us yearnings. He gives us desires for Christ as we read the text. Let's look at a couple texts here. Revelation 22:17. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who desires take the waters of life without price. So the Holy Spirit is bidding people to come to the living waters. To the one who alone can satisfy all of our thirst. It reminds you of what John wrote earlier in John chapter 4 in his gospel, right? That Jesus is able to give you the living waters. That he himself is able to eternally satisfy as the one who is better than Jacob, but not just the one who's better than Jacob, the one who's better than Jacob's well. Right? Remember the lady was speaking to him. Are you better than our father Jacob? And Jesus says, I'm not only better than the father Jacob, I'm better than the well that Jacob dug. Because if you have me, you have living water. So the Spirit here is bidding us come to Christ. Which means he produces in us yearnings, longings, and desires for Jesus. Which can only be met and satisfied in the Word. Look also at John 6:56. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. Christ here is bidding us to come and know him. And the Spirit is the one who makes that even possible. The picture here, once again, is relationship. You're dwelling in Christ, and Christ is dwelling in you. The picture here is of intimate fellowship and intimate relationship. And in that intimate fellowship and in that intimate relationship, we are able to come and know and experience Christ more fully. In fact, what Jesus will say later. John 15:5, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, it is he that bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Again, this creates this cyclical idea in our hermeneutics, doesn't it? That without Christ, without being in that relationship with him, and without being in union with him, you can do nothing. That includes reading the Bible rightly. That includes having the correct hermeneutical grid. In that sense, what we're saying is reading this book is very different than any other book. This is not a book that just anyone can pick up and come to right conclusions apart from relationship. You have to have the existing relationship in order to read it rightly. You can pick up the works of Plato, and you don't need to have a relationship with Plato to read it and understand it. You can pick up any book in the back of a library, and you don't need to know the author to understand it. But here's what's being said. There's a degree in which you cannot understand the text apart from a relationship with the author. The Bible, then, is a supernatural book. It's a supernatural book in which you cannot approach it with the same rules or even with the same hermeneutics that you approach other books with. It's a book in which you must know the author if you're to understand the author's writings. This gets into the idea, and you'll read parts of this book, what John Piper calls reading the Bible supernaturally. Reading the Bible supernaturally. You have several sections of this in your reading, as I mentioned, but let's look at a text here. Matthew 23:2-3. The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. So do they observe whatever they tell you, but not the works they do. For they preach, but they do not practice. Jesus says that they're standing in the line of Moses, right? But they've missed the goal of the law, which is internal transformation and relationship with God. And Jesus will say time and time and time again to the Pharisees, have you not read this? Have you not read this? Do you have eyes but you can't see? What's the point? You can have the Bible memorized front and back and still not get it. You can know it inside and out. You can know what it's saying. You can know it in multiple languages and still not get it. Because the text is not just objective. It's not just meant to be analyzed. The text is primarily a channel through which we commune with God. The text is primarily a channel through which we commune with God. The idea is it is relational. It's a supernatural act, reading this word. So there's some hindrances then, right? There are hindrances to reading the Bible rightly. The first would be Satan. Satan can hinder you from reading the Bible rightly. Because, you remember what he's called? The father of lies? John 8:44. You are of your father, the devil. And your will is to do your father's desires. He's a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. The desire of the devil is to kill you spiritually, to make sure that you don't see in the text the glories of Christ, and he's actively at work to make sure you don't, believe it or not. And in that sense, did you know that reading the Bible is spiritual warfare? Picking up this book at 6 a.m. and trying to read it, drowsy-eyed and trying to get something from it of Christ, that's spiritual warfare. When you think of spiritual warfare, it's not tend to think of these big moments of speaking in tongues and casting out demons and things like that. But the natural act of reading the Bible, if the Bible is truth, John 17:17, sanctify them in your truth, your word is truth, and Satan hates the truth, then reading the Bible is spiritual warfare. Think of Adam and Eve in Genesis 3. What was the very first thing that Satan did? The very first thing that Satan did in the story of the Bible is twist God's words. He twisted God's word. He said, did God not really say this? Well, you know, if you eat of it, you won't truly die. He twisted God's words. And think of what he did to Jesus even in Matthew 4. Satan quotes God's word to Jesus in the temptation. He actually quotes from the Psalms to Jesus. Satan knows the Bible. And he can use the Bible to make you blind to the Bible. Satan seeks in scriptures to take away affections for God, even as the scripture is read. Let's look at Matthew 13:19. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. Remember this parable. This is Satan's desire. That the glories of the gospel in scripture would not take deep root in your heart as you read the Bible. His desire is that, this is Satan's desire, that you would wake up in the morning to read your Bible and get nothing out of it. This is his desire, that you would wake up in the morning to read your Bible and get distracted by whatever you have to do for that day. Or get distracted by a text that shows up on your phone. This is Satan's desire, that you would sit down to read your Bible, and instead of seeing the glories of Christ, you see something that God cares very little about. And that you spend your entire day meditating on something that has nothing to do with Christ and his gospel. Satan desires to come and pluck that seed away. And he seeks to blind us to the beauty of Christ in Scripture. Let's look at 2 Corinthians 4. Verses 3 through 4. If our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world, Satan, has blinded their minds to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ. Satan's desire is to blind people's minds so that they wouldn't see Christ in the gospel. So they wouldn't see Christ in Scripture. The focus of what Satan is blinding you to, or desires to, no, I'm not saying he is, sorry. The focus of what Satan desires to blind you to is Christ. In that sense, doesn't this make, if the goal of Revelation is a relationship, and if the content of Revelation is Christ, then what Satan is doing is trying to make Revelation ineffective. Satan knows the goal of Revelation is a relationship, and Satan knows the central message of God's relationship is Christ. Here's what Satan doesn't care about, okay? If, and let me tell you a kind of Bible reading that Satan likes. Did you know there's a kind of Bible reading that Satan likes? He loves it when you wake up in the morning and all you do is memorize facts from the Bible. Just memorize a bunch of random facts. Who was the father of Abraham? Who was the tenth generation from so-and-so? And he loves that. He loves it when you read the Bible for history and history only. He loves it when you read the Bible just as a piece of good literature or good poetry or images. He loves it because Revelation is not accomplishing its goal, which is relationship with God in Christ. The kind of Bible reading that Satan loves is the kind of Bible reading that distracts you from Christ. So that's the first hindrance is Satan, but beyond Satan is sin, our own sin. Our own sin makes it impossible to read the Bible supernaturally, to read the Bible as a book inviting us into relationship. Consider Ephesians 2, 1 through 3. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, and the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. This is the point, right? Satan is leading people here away from following Christ, but we're complicit. Okay, we're following our own desires, and that's point number three. We carry out the desires of the body and the mind. In this sense, you know, Satan is certainly leading people astray, but he doesn't lead people astray against what they already desire. He leads people towards what they already desire, which is not God, which is not the gospel. This is the point. We're complicit. The problem is that we tend to love sin more than we love Christ, and so we would rather not see Christ in Scripture. We'd rather see a bunch of other things that make us proud because we know more theology than the other guy, or we know what that random historical fact was. And all of that, not seeing Christ. Remember, we saw Romans 1:18. The natural disposition of men is to suppress the glory of God and unrighteousness. And this is because at the core, rejecting Christ is bound to our affections. Look at John 3:19. And this is the judgment, that light has come into the world and people loved darkness rather than light because their works were evil. Our biggest problem is not Satan. Our biggest problem is not this world. Our biggest problem is not poverty or sickness or anything like that. You know what our biggest problem is? Our biggest problem is that we tend to love darkness rather than light. And light can shine brightly. The light of Christ can shine brightly in Scripture, and we don't see it because we'd rather not. In fact, only the spiritual person is able to understand the things of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians 2:13 through 14. We impart this in word, not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. That means the stakes are high. Okay? Did you know that sin makes it harder to read the Bible? Did you know that? Like, if the Bible really is a relational document, and if a ministry of the Holy Spirit is to illuminate Christ in the document, that means part of hermeneutics is when you're sitting in your bed at 10 p.m., and your phone is right there, and you want to pull up that video, you say no. That's hermeneutics. And if you say yes, it makes it harder to read the Bible. Part of hermeneutics, okay, is when you're tempted to lie or you're tempted to steal, fighting in that moment to not do it is part of hermeneutics. Because this is not a natural book. It's a supernatural book, and a ministry of the Holy Spirit is to make clear the gospel of Christ in it. And if the Holy Spirit's ministry is dampened because of sin, because you've grieved the Holy Spirit, because these truths are discerned through the Spirit, they're spiritually discerned, that means they're discerned through the Spirit, part of hermeneutics is your own personal holiness. So this is what that means, okay? Satan's against us. Our own sin is against us. What we need then is a miracle. Because we are, Luke 24:24, slow of heart. We're slow of heart, naturally. Think of what Christ says there in Luke 24:24. What does he get at? Verse 25. He says they're foolish and slow of heart. This is what he doesn't say. It's not that they weren't able to read Scripture rightly with Christ at the center because they were stupid. Or because they didn't know the original language as well. Or they didn't know the 10 rules well. It was because of their heart. They were slow of heart, and so they were unable to read Scripture rightly. It was their affections primarily. He calls them foolish. What's the fool in Scripture? Psalm 14, verse 1. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. That's what the fool is. Wisdom begins with the fear of the Lord, right? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Wisdom versus foolishness is not primarily an intellectual category in Scripture. Wisdom versus foolishness is primarily a submission category. It's primarily a relational category. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, Proverbs 1, verse 7. So even when he calls them foolish, what he's not saying is you're an idiot intellectually. You're intellectually incapable. He's not saying that. He's saying there's a spiritual problem behind the fact that you don't see Christ. There's a spiritual problem behind it. And so, Psalm 119, verse 18. Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. What does he mean by wondrous things? What are the wondrous things that we should want to see in God's Word? Yeah, I think Christ. The most precious of things. He's not talking about being able to intellectually understand or being able to remember what's in Genesis 12, 15, and 17. Abrahamic covenant. Great. That's not a wondrous thing. The wondrous thing to behold in Scripture is God reaching out to you that he and you might be in relationship, might have a confirmed relationship, might be progressed in your relationship. It's Christ. This means reading is a very natural act. You don't need the Holy Spirit to read, right? You need eyes. And you need to know letters and vocabulary. Then you can read. But you do need the Holy Spirit to read the Bible rightly. You do need the Holy Spirit to read the Bible rightly. And so, what does Christ do? Luke 24:45. He opened their minds to understand the Scriptures. He opened their minds. It's a spiritual activity. Reading this book is not a natural thing. It's a spiritual activity. Knowing what this book is about is not the same as just reading the words on the page. There's something far more that this book is doing, this book is trying to accomplish. And look, it's not even what he opens their minds to do. It's not even to enter into a saving relationship with God, right? I mean, certainly that is what has to happen. But in this text, he has to open their minds so they can understand the Bible. These are his disciples. They must have their minds open to understand the Bible. This is how Paul describes it in 2 Corinthians 4, 4 and 5. Again, the God of this world has blinded their minds, but we proclaim Christ, in verse 6, For God, who said that light shine out of darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's what God is doing. The context of this is in chapter 3. Look at what he says. What's he contrasting here? When he says that he has given us the light of God in the face of Jesus Christ, I don't think he's primarily addressing categories of regeneration. I think he's primarily addressing categories of illumination. Because look at what he says. Now, if the ministry of death, carved in letters on stone, came with such glory that the Israelites could not gaze at Moses' face because of its glory, which is being brought to an end, won't the ministry of the Spirit have even more glory? For if there was glory in the ministry of condemnation, the ministry of righteousness must far exceed its glory. Indeed, in this case, what once had glory has come to have no glory at all. That's the old covenant. Because there's a glory that surpassed it. For if what was being brought to an end came with glory, much more what was permanent have glory. Now this is what he says. He's contrasting the old and the new covenant. For since we have such a hope, we are very bold. Not like Moses put a veil over his face so the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end. But their minds were hardened. For to this day, when one reads the Old Testament, the same veil remains unlifted. The veil that was over Moses' face so the people couldn't see the glory. Okay? When the Old Covenant is read, that veil is still there. And that same veil remains unlifted because only through Christ is that veil taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. The biggest issue here is that in the synagogues, they are reading the Old Testament and they don't see Jesus. The veil must be removed so that, verse 18, we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord. Where are they beholding the glory of the Lord? In the Old Testament. That's what the whole text is saying. It's not just this general, I behold God because I'm a Christian. It's beholding the glory of the Lord because the veil that hides the glory of the Lord in the Old Testament has been removed. But that's a spiritual act that the Holy Spirit must do. So here's the question. Are we aware of this category? Do we read our Bibles like this is true? I tend to not. I tend to wake up in the morning and I kind of do my reading and I feel like I'm good. Right? I have to remind myself of this. Now with this ministry of the Holy Spirit to illuminate Christ to us in the text of Scripture, in that sense, what we're doing, what we're seeking here, right? So all this is in relationship. It's a divine human encounter. What we're seeking here is an experiential reading of Scripture. I don't mean that like a crazy pente. When people ask me, am I pente or orthodox, you know what I say to them? I say to them, I'm pente, but I'm not crazy. And they always laugh. If they're pente or orthodox, they laugh. They think it's funny. I'm not saying I'm a crazy pente when I say an experiential reading of Scripture, but I am saying this. If we really believe it's a divine human encounter, and the goal of revelation is relationship with God, and the Bible is revelation, and the Holy Spirit must come and do a work of illumination so that we can understand the words of Scripture. If everything I've said last week and this week is true, then what we're seeking is an experiential reading of Scripture. Okay, we don't just come to learn history. We don't just come to learn theology. We don't just come to learn facts. That's the kind of Bible reading that Satan loves. We come to Scripture expecting to experience the God who wrote it. We expect to experience nearness to the God who wrote Scripture. It's primarily relational. We expect to have spiritual experiences with God as we read Scripture. Now, when I say spiritual experiences, don't hear speaking in tongues. Hear experiences of faith in Christ. How is our relationship with God created, confirmed, continued? Faith in Christ. But that means what we're looking for when we read Scripture is an experience of knowing our need for the gospel and experiencing further faith in the gospel. Okay, why do you come to morning worship in the morning and the first thing we do is read the law and the second thing we do is read the gospel? Because we need the gospel. We have to be reminded that we are sinners, and we have to be reminded that Jesus died for sinners. That informs our Sunday morning liturgy as well. Do you notice, and you'll talk about this in your worship class, but do you notice the progression of our songs that we even sing on Sunday morning? That always starts with adoration, and then an awareness of our sin and confession, and then assurance of pardon in the gospel, and then commitment to follow Christ. It's experiential and it's gospel-centered is the goal. So let's look at Luke 24:32. This is what the disciples on the road to Emmaus said after Christ. Well, Christ preached to them, but then he broke the bread, right? And then they say this: did our hearts not burn within us as he spoke to us? When I'm talking about an experiential reading of Scripture or a charismatic reading of Scripture, I'm not talking about a reading of Scripture that produces speaking in tongues or is casting demons out of the chair that I'm sitting on. I'm not talking about that. I'm saying we want our hearts to burn within us as we hear Christ speak to us in Scripture. To read that God loves us and to feel as we do that God does love us. We already saw Ephesians 3:14-19 last week. But Paul's prayer, at the end of explaining the glories of the gospel, Paul's prayer is for an experience of the Spirit coming so that they would know that Christ loves them. The reading of Scripture doesn't reach its full intended effect until our hearts burn within us as Christ spoke with us. So here's what, there's two extremes of this, okay? One extreme looks like this. It's just seeking some kind of experience, some kind of heightened emotions. I want to read the Bible until I have a heightened emotion, okay? That would be wrong. That would be wrong. What we're not chasing is a heightened emotional experience through reading Scripture. What we're chasing is a person, and as we experience that person and his goodness, and as we hear him speak to us and open to us the Scripture, we have the experience of our hearts burning within us. We have the experience of knowing that these truths are true, right? We don't experience joy in the gospel until we've know the gospel. We don't know what it feels like to have assurance of salvation until we remember that Christ has died for our sins. What we're not seeking then is assurance of salvation. What we're seeking is knowledge of Christ. What we're seeking is to know Christ so that we would experience Christ in the text of Scripture. There is a sense in which growth in the gospel is not measured solely. Now, that word is important, solely. Growth in the gospel is not measured solely in knowledge of the gospel, but joy in the gospel and depth of experience. You can know what justification is and not be a Christian. You can know what penal substitutionary atonement is and not be a Christian. You can know what adoption is and not be a Christian. It must be met with faith, which is an experience an experience of belief in the truths that are being proclaimed. So what kind of experiences should we expect as we seek Christ? Strength in faith would be one. Ephesians 6:23. Right? Faith from God. As we pursue God and as we know God and as we enjoy God in Scripture, we experience strength in faith. How about joy in our salvation? Psalm 51:12. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. How about what it feels like to be loved by God? Romans 5:5. Hope does not put to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit given to us. Compare that with Ephesians 3 that we've already seen. Peace with God. Romans 5:1. Since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. How about renewed hope? Hope does not put us to shame. An experience of hope. An experience of beholding Christ, Luke 24:45, that we've already looked at several times. He opened their minds to understand the Scriptures. And when he does, what does he open their minds to in the Scriptures? Not just general categories of truth in the Scriptures. He opens their mind to the fact that Christ must suffer and die and be resurrected. He opens their minds to the gospel in the text. With that is certainly an experience of moral transformation, right? Love your neighbor should happen, but even the command, love your neighbor, and the experience of more obedience flows from the gospel in the first place. Ephesians 4:1. Walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. The gospel precedes all of that. I want to talk about the importance of prayer in Bible reading. The importance of prayer in Bible reading. If the goal is primarily relational, then we should expect and desire to engage God with God in a relational way in Scripture through the gospel, and part of that would be prayer. Let me read you a quote by Charles Spurgeon. We may hammer away at a text some time in meditation, strike it again and again, and yet it may not yield to us. But we cry to God, and straightway the text opens, and we see concealed in it wondrous treasures of wisdom and grace. To read only is unprofitable. To read only is unprofitable. To pray without reading is not soul enriching. But when the two run together, they're like a horse pulling a chariot. They speed along merrily. Consider even Ephesians 1 that we already looked at. Paul's prayer that the Spirit would come and open their minds. That prayer, here's a very obvious statement. That prayer is a prayer. Right? That prayer is a prayer. That the realities of the gospel would be true in the minds of those who are reading Paul. Okay, I want to do this for a moment. Let's do a group project. Open your Bibles to Psalm 119, which is a prayer. Psalm 119, and just find a few verses that speak to the psalmist's longing to understand Scripture and to know God in Scripture. So just do that with the people in your group. Find a few that you especially like, and then we'll hear it together. Any interesting observations? Any texts especially stand out to you? Look at verse 12. Blessed are you, O Lord, teach me your statutes. Who's his teacher? God. Look at verse 26. When I told of my ways, you answered me, teach me your statutes. Verse 33. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will keep it to the end. Verse 64. The earth, O Lord, is full of your steadfast love. Teach me your statutes. Verse 66. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe your commandments. 68. You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. 124. Deal with your servant according to steadfast love. Teach me your statutes. So the Lord is his teacher as he reads it. This is the divine human encounter that we were talking about yesterday, that he would encounter God, and as he encounters God, that God would be his teacher. I think also, look at verse 36. Can someone read verse 36? Incline my heart. This is what we saw earlier, right? That the primary problem is on an affections level. It's that we desire sin more than we desire the truths of God's word. Again, this is an affections level battle, and he knows this. He knows he has tendencies towards a lack of desire for God's word, and he has tendencies towards a lack of desire to obey God's word. So this is the greatest battle that we'll fight, the greatest spiritual battle we'll fight in our lives is the battle for our affections. The greatest spiritual battle we'll ever fight in our lives is the battle for our affections, right? We know God, look at 1 Peter 2:2. God commands our affections, you know that? Like newborn infants long for the pure spiritual milk, as you may grow up into salvation. Do you see him commanding your affections here? He commands you to long for the Bible. Long for the Bible, which, by the way, what's the result of reading the Bible in this text? That you may grow into salvation, which means the gospel is the central message of the Bible. That aside, though, He actually does command your affections here. He commands you to want the Bible. It's a command that you can't do, right? It's very difficult, if not impossible, to change the way you feel about something. But here, he commands your actual affections. But the good news is that in the God who commands our affections is the God who changes us into people who say, Psalm 119, 97, oh, how I love your law. Right? It is possible. It's possible for us to say that from the bottom of our heart. It's possible for us to mean it deeply. But it's only possible on the foundation of a heart that's been transformed by the Holy Spirit through the gospel. Right? Only the gospel has the power to take someone who's dead in sins and alive in their affections to love God's word. Do you know what that means? We need more than anything, we need the gospel in the text of Scripture so that we can grow up into salvation. And as we pray for those desires, we fight for them. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have heard me. Right? Part of the battle of reading the Bible well is to not love sin, but to love Christ instead. There's something more foundational is what I'm getting at than just reading the words on the page. It's possible. Here's what's at risk. Look at Hebrews 5:11. It's possible to become dull of hearing. You know that? It's possible to become dull of hearing. That's an experiential idea, right? It's possible for Christians to become dull of hearing. They have much to explain about the Bible, but they can't do it because they have become dull of hearing. So part of the fight then is that God would open our eyes to see the beauty of Christ in Scripture, because again, the intention is relationship. That's the goal. Look at Psalm 17, verse 15. This should be our prayer as we read. As for me, I shall behold your face in righteousness. When I awake, I shall be satisfied in your likeness. That's the goal of reading Scripture, to behold the face of Christ as we read it, so we will be satisfied. So there's a foundational battle that, in some senses, is part of our hermeneutical grid, because it has nothing to do with our exegesis. It has to do with, is this going to have its full intended effect in my life of fellowship with God in Christ? But with that, our lifestyle, here's how I want to end this lecture. Our lifestyle really deeply affects this. Our lifestyle deeply affects our desire for God's word, and our lifestyle deeply affects our ability to read God's word well and be affected by it. Let's look at John 8, 42 through 44 again. Jesus said, "If God were your Father, you should love me, for I came from God, and here I am. I came not to do of my own accord, but of him who sent me. Why do you not understand what I say?" Why do you not understand what Jesus says? It's because you can't bear with his word. You are of the father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because the truth is not in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character. He's a liar and the father of lies. More foundational here is than reading the text, more foundational to reading the text, is the fact that their hearts are inclined away from God. James 1:22 summarizes this well. Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. The word of God reaches its full effect as there's a relational element to it, and part of that relational element is that we live a life that shows the glories of the gospel by being transformed by the gospel. That we live like God our Father and not like Satan is our Father. That we live a life that desires an outcome. Or we read in a way that desires an outcome of holiness. We live a life that looks like it's been transformed by the gospel. James 1:21 says this. This is the posture. This is the posture we must have. Put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness, and receive with humility the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. We must receive it in humility, which is in contrast to living a wicked lifestyle. What humility looks like, we're ready for it to teach us. We're quick to listen to what it says. We're slow to argue or slow to respond. But the outcome of receiving God's word with humility is salvation. Right? The outcome of receiving God's word with humility is salvation. Do you know what that means? Not that our humility saves us. It means that the gospel is the central message of Scripture. And humbly receiving it looks like getting the gospel from it. The word is only able to save your souls if you get the gospel in it. Otherwise, the text means your humility somehow earns your salvation. No, receiving with humility looks like believing the gospel as you read the word. So here's the hope, and we'll be done with this lecture, but here's our hope. He gives more grace, James 4:6. God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And if you submit to God, as his will is expressed in his word and as his gospel is expressed in his word, you are resisting the devil. And he is going to flee. And as we draw near to God, in his word, he promises he will draw near to you. Now, how do we draw near to God in his word? Through the gospel. The only way to draw near to God is through faith in Christ. We don't draw near to God in his word by showing him the good things we've done. We should draw near to God in his word by trusting Christ more. Hebrews 11, verse 4. If we approach God, we must approach him in faith. Because without faith, we can't please him. That's what drawing near to God looks like. And as we do, we will find that we hate our sin and we reject it and we repent of it. We are wretched and we weep and we mourn and we humble ourselves before the Lord by submitting to his gospel so that he will exalt us. Exaltation now as we encounter God in Scripture, but exaltation later as we encounter God and see him face to face on the final day. So there's a massive relational element then to the reading of Scripture. Okay? It's reading the Bible well is not a matter of learning 10 tools for reading the literal sense of the text, and now you're good to go. It is far more complicated than that. Now, you do need to learn the rules for reading the literal sense of the text, but before you ever learn those rules, this is what you need. You need this. We move on now to the next point in our lecture, which then is interested not with what questions, right? We just covered what questions. What is our goal in hermeneutics? And I was arguing it's relational. Now we get into some how questions. How do we do that? How do we read the Bible with Jesus at the center, with his gospel at the forefront? How do we, if our goal in hermeneutics, we said, is to foster God's intention with revelation, or God's intention for revelation, how do we do that? Faithfully. How to do that faithfully? Well, we did start by saying that the Bible is the way we get our hermeneutical method. The Bible should be the means by which we would get our hermeneutical method. And so, we're going to start with that. We're going to start with how the Bible teaches us to read the Bible. Was there a question? Yeah, what's up? Can an unbeliever understand the Scriptures? In some ways, yes. In some ways, no. Right? In some ways, yes, because they're able to just read the words on the page. Right? And they can say they have linguistic tools, things like that. But in other ways, no. Right? Because they're not able to understand the full... they're not able to understand and experience the full intention that God has in Scripture. So it's a bit of a nuanced answer there, but the Bible does say that the Lord must be our teacher to understand it. And so that'd be the primary emphasis I would put on it. In some way, they are able to understand the Bible, right? But they're not able to get the goal of the Bible, which is knowledge of Christ, experiencing Christ, having faith in Christ, which that alone should show us that the Bible, God's goal in the Bible is far more than us being able to read the words on the page, right? If we're doing a kind of Bible reading that an unbeliever can do, then we're probably not reading the Bible the right way, right? So the question itself maybe even reveals, you know, what assumptions do I have about what reading the Bible is meant to be like? Or what assumptions do I have about the goals of reading the Bible, right? If mine and an unbeliever's are the same or could be the same, then maybe my goals are wrong, right? Does that make sense? So are unbelievers able to understand the plain words on the page? Yes, they absolutely are. But they're not able to understand the fullness of what God is saying in his revelation because they don't have the Holy Spirit, I think. Yeah, unbelievers can read the Bible and be converted. In fact, that's the only way that they can be converted is through the gospel found in Scripture. That's how the Holy Spirit chooses to work, right? So the goal of God's revelation is relationship. And he accomplishes that goal through the text of Scripture, relationship, as the Holy Spirit accompanies it with power. Here's what I want to do. I want now to take a moment to learn hermeneutics from the Bible. I want to learn hermeneutics from the Bible. What we've said is that the Bible, right, should, the goal of Revelation should be our goal in hermeneutics. And I do think that with that, the Bible should teach us how to read the Bible. The Bible should teach us how to read the Bible. I don't think that what we should do is say, okay, the Bible has given us everything we need to know thus far, and now that it's time to actually read the Bible, I'm going to come up with 10 rules outside the Bible, and those rules are going to govern how I read the Bible. That would be a bit inconsistent. I think the consistent thing to do next is say, how does the Bible teach me to read the Bible? How does the Bible teach me to read the Bible? And the primary way that we observe that is the way the New Testament authors read the Old Testament. The way the New Testament authors read the Old Testament. So with that, Jesus, you remember, Jesus opened the eyes of his disciples so that they would understand the Scriptures. Right? Then those disciples wrote the Bible. So if Jesus opened their mind to understand the Scriptures, and they did understand the Scriptures, and then they wrote the Bible, you would think that whatever Jesus taught them about how to read the Bible is contained in their writings. And in that sense, we're looking then not just to interesting thoughts that people have had about the Old Testament. We're actually looking to them as disciples and followers of Christ, not just to follow them ethically, not just to follow them in their faith in Christ, but to follow them in their hermeneutical methodology as well. So let's think about that. What does it look like to read the Bible the way the apostles did, in the way that Jesus did? What does it look like to do that, and how does that teach us how to do it faithfully? I do think that primary to the New Testament authors was the idea of literal readings of the text. Literal readings of the text, which are important. Literal readings of the text are important. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 10. Okay. You can see here, I do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, that our fathers were under the clouds. It actually happened, okay? Cain really killed Abel. Moses really parted the Red Sea. Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, okay? These things truly happened in history. Romans 5, there was an Adam who actually disobeyed God, okay? And in this sense, we're reading it in light of just what the text is saying. You could say this, the literal sense of the text is just simply what the words on the page say. It's just what the words on the page say. And taking it at face value, right? And the interpreters of the Bible do this consistently. God really said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And we read it to say that, okay? Why is this important? It's important because we have a historical faith, right? And as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, 14 through 19, if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. Right? The historical event of the resurrection, and yes, the historical event of everything before it and everything after it that's in the Bible must be grounded in history. These things truly and literally happened. If Moses didn't part the Red Sea, if David didn't kill Goliath, if Solomon didn't build the temple, if Ezra didn't read the law to those who returned from exile, our faith is in vain. That's what I think that means. Foundationally, the literal sense of the text is important because our faith is one that's grounded in history. Our faith is one that's grounded in history. So there's a reality of divine speech, okay, that contains literal things and describes actual realities, right? When we read Exodus 14, we read about Moses parting the Red Sea, and that is God's speech, and it actually happened. It actually happened. And we can trust the literal sense because Titus 1:2, God never lies. God never lies. And so the implication is the words that are said are meant to be trusted. And in honoring the literal sense of the text, in honoring the historical nature of the events that are being described, we are honoring the God who never lies. And the authority of Scripture itself is found and is only found in the words of Scripture. Not in man-made ideas or other things. So Jesus governs this world, and he does so through his word. And Jesus governs his church, and he does so through his word. And the Spirit is speaking in every detail of Scripture, and if we're to hear him, we must hear him in the words that he has spoken. But I do think that the New Testament authors go beyond the literal sense of the text. I don't think they just end at the literal sense of the text. For instance, remember in Acts, when Paul is debating in the synagogues with the Jewish leaders, he's not debating about the literal sense of the text. He's debating about if Jesus is there in the text. What he's doing then, he's not importing Jesus onto the text. He is seeing and debating with them if Jesus can be seen in the text and exegeting the text, not enforcing Jesus onto the text, but if, based on the literal sense of the text, based upon the way that him and the Jews were reading the text, if these are truly Christian scriptures. Now, in some sense, everyone does spiritual readings of the text, okay? Genesis 4, Cain killed Abel. Now, if you're preaching Genesis 4 in a strictly literal sense, the only thing you can say about that text is Cain killed Abel. As soon as you say don't kill people, you're not reading the literal sense of the text anymore. You've gone beyond the literal sense of the text, because you can go to Genesis 4 right now. Genesis 4 does not say don't kill people. Right? Now, Cain is certainly a negative example. There's a bad outcome for Cain, but the text does not say don't kill people. The text actually doesn't apply itself in any way. If we want to know how to apply that text, we have to read the New Testament authors and the way that they applied that text, right? And they do. In fact, John says, don't be like Cain and kill people. So good news. Good news, you can have moral readings of the text not because I think I like moral readings of the text, but because the Bible has moral readings of the text, right? All of our spiritual readings of the text, including moral readings, should be grounded in what the text itself teaches us and how the text teaches us to read it. So in some senses, okay, We should do spiritual readings of the text because it's impossible to not do spiritual readings of the text. Everyone does spiritual readings of the text. The question is not, do you do spiritual readings? The question is, are you aware of the spiritual readings that you're doing? As soon as you stand up and you read the Cain and Abel story and say, don't kill people, you're going beyond the text. You've gone beyond the text. Now, I think that the New Testament authors primarily have three categories in mind, and all three are built on the literal sense of the text. And by literal, I mean the words on the page. I think they have three categories in mind, and they're the categories of faith, hope, and love. And all three of these are spiritual readings of the text. All three of these are spiritual readings of the text. They go beyond the literal meaning to ask. We talked about understanding and interpreting Scripture, right? Understanding, maybe you could equate it to the literal meaning of the text, and interpreting, you could maybe equate to the spiritual readings of the text. So let's look at one example that we looked at earlier, okay? We looked already at Matthew 2:15, out of Egypt I called my son. Remember that? Quoting Hosea 11, verse 1. So on first glance, it looks like Matthew is saying that there's a prediction in Hosea that Jesus would come from Egypt. There's a couple problems, though. Let's all turn there. Look at it in your Bibles. Let's turn there so we can see the page. But let's look at Matthew chapter 2. Is there anything in there that would help you see what Hosea is doing? I'm sorry, what Matthew is doing or not. I do want to do one thing to make it a little bit more complicated, maybe. Okay, so first of all, we said that Hosea 11:1 was not a prediction of Jesus leaving Egypt. It was, in fact, a historical description of Israel being rescued from Egypt. Now, here's one thing that's very interesting also. This is what it says. This is the quotation in verse 15. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. Now, do you know what's really, really strange about that? I mean, first of all, it's strange if you understand the Hosea quotation, but it's also strange because you would expect Matthew to put this in the text as Jesus was leaving Egypt, not as he was going to Egypt. It doesn't say, into Egypt I called my son. It says, out of Egypt I called my son, right? So not only is Hosea 11:1 not a prophecy, but Matthew seems to put it in a very, very, very strange place. You would think instead that it would go where, let's see, maybe after verse 19? No, after verse 20? No, after verse 21? How about this? Wouldn't this make more sense? Verse 21, he rose and took the child and his mother and went into the land of Israel, as it was written, out of Egypt I called my son. But he puts it before. He doesn't put it as he goes out of Egypt. He puts it when he goes into Egypt. What is Matthew doing? Well, I do think that Matthew is doing something very intentional. I think he's doing something very intentional here. I think he is engaging in spiritual exegesis. I think he's, if we're going to put this in the categories of faith, hope, and love, this is the category of faith. I'll define all these better later. But look at what happens in this text, okay? Have you heard this story before? In Matthew's gospel, we have a character named Joseph. And Joseph has dreams. And in Joseph, I mean, he has multiple dreams throughout it. And in Joseph's dreams, God's people are rescued by going down to Egypt. Now, beyond that, we also have a king who wants to kill all of the children, 2 years old and under. That king calls magicians, sorcerers, and they try to discern for him what is happening. And then God's son goes through the waters in chapter 3. Have you heard that story before? I've heard that story before. It sounds a lot like the Genesis and Exodus story, doesn't it? So, in the Exodus story, Israel is rescued through Joseph who dreams. And in the Matthew story, Jesus is rescued through Joseph who dreams. In the Exodus story, Pharaoh kills all the male Israelite children. And in the Jesus story, Herod kills all the male Israelite children. In the Israel story, Pharaoh summons sorcerers and magicians to help him. And in the Matthew story, Herod summons the chief priests, the scribes, and the magi, the magicians, to help him. That's what magi means. You know, it's wise men, but they're astrologers. These wise men who see Jesus are magicians. Then, Exodus 14, Israel passes through the Red Sea, and in Matthew 3, Jesus passes through the Jordan River and is declared over him, "This is my beloved son." Again, we have to think of, "Out of Egypt I called my son." What's happening here? I think there's a couple things that are happening here. Number one, Jesus is reliving the Israel story. Jesus is reliving the Israel story. Because even if you think about it in the Gospel of Matthew, after Jesus goes through the waters of the Jordan, where does he go? Into the wilderness for 40 days. Just as Israel went to the wilderness for 40 years. And after going through the wilderness for 40 days, he then goes up onto a mountain where he gives his law. Right? That's Matthew 5 through 7. Then, after going onto a mountain where he gives his law, what happens in chapter 8? He comes down from the mountain and he casts out demons and he heals the sick. My friends, he conquers the promised land. Jesus relives the Israel story. So what's happening here in this quotation? Jesus is called out of Egypt, but not out of literal Egypt. Jesus is called out of spiritual Egypt. Herod is the new Pharaoh. And Israel has become the new Egypt. Jesus must be rescued not out of physical Egypt. Literal Egypt becomes the place of rescue, not the place of danger. The place of danger for God's people in Matthew's gospel is Israel. So what's he saying? Israel has become spiritual Egypt. And Jesus is reliving the Exodus story. That's what's being said, I think. In that sense, this is how Matthew says to fulfill what the Lord spoke by the prophet. Prophecy works a couple ways, I think, in the Old Testament. It works, one, through proclamation, or maybe a better word is prediction, predictive prophecy. And number two is typological prophecy. Typological prophecy. So typology, typological prophecy, is prophecy not through prophetic announcements, Jesus will go down to Egypt, but prophecy through patterns, prophecy through story. And we will talk more about what in the world that means throughout this class. But in short, now, what this means is patterns that occur over and over and over again in the Bible are meant to culminate in the person of Jesus. So even the idea of calling Jesus my son, that has connotations of Adam as the Son of God, as Luke calls him. Israel as the Son of God. David as the Son of God. It calls to mind not just God's people in general, but the idea of the Adam repetition. You know, the Bible is full of new Adams. In fact, 1 Corinthians 15 does not call Jesus the second Adam. Do you know what Jesus is called in 1 Corinthians 15? The final Adam. The last Adam. Which implies maybe there's more than two Adams. Maybe, just as Adam failed in the garden by eating the fruit of the tree, so then Noah fails in the vineyard by drinking the wine and becoming drunk and getting naked in his tent and having his nakedness exposed, and then curses are pronounced. Maybe then also Israel, who is brought into the promised land and then by means of listening to foreign gods is kicked out of the promised land as a new Adam as well. Maybe David, who God entered into covenant with and called David my son, but who fails. Solomon, who fails. Maybe all of these are new Adams. Solomon, who not only built a temple, but planted trees throughout all of the promised land and made gold and bdellium prominent throughout. Stones that are found in the promised land are in the Garden of Eden, right? Maybe all of these are second and third and fourth Adams, and the Bible doesn't just work like a linear story going from one end to the next, but throughout it, there are repeating themes and repeating ideas and repeated failures. So that in a sense, there are many new Adams waiting for the final Adam Christ to come. Maybe there are many spiritual Egypts throughout it, waiting for Christ to come. That's the category of faith. Faith, in short, asks this question. Who is the Christ in whom I must believe? Whom is the Christ in, or who is the Christ in whom I must believe? In that sense, it's telling us about what Christ would do in the gospel. That's what faith is telling us. Love is telling us, how do I live a righteous life based upon what Christ has done? Based upon the truths of the gospel, look at Luke 17:32. Remember Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife. This is a text talking about the day of judgment that's coming upon Jerusalem. And on that day, Jesus says, don't turn around. Don't turn around and go back for your cloak. Because remember what happened to Lot's wife, right? If you remember what happened to Lot's wife, she turned into a pillar of salt. So don't be like her, be like Lot. Keep running. Run away quickly and keep going. And don't turn around to get your cloak on that day. He's using the Sodom and Gomorrah story to tell you how to live a righteous life, how to obey the commandments of God. Now that God has rescued you from the city of destruction, and he's given you hope in an eternal city, run from it as fast as you can, that city of destruction, and don't even turn around. Let me give you the final category, and that's the category of hope. And we'll spend a long time in all of these categories, so don't worry. Look at Hebrews 11, verse 10. All I'm trying to do right now is not get deep into any of these categories, but just showing you that they're all there. We'll get into what they are. But Hebrews 11, verse 10 says this. Abraham was looking forward to a city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. So he's looking forward to a city which is described in 12 verse 22 as Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem. You probably don't see that in the Genesis story, do you? But he does. So in that sense, faith tells me what to believe about what Christ has done and dying for our sins and rescuing us from eternal judgment. Love tells me how to live a righteous life in light of that gospel. And hope is the eschatological reading. Hope tells me about what Jesus will do to make all things right at the end. I think all three of these are found in Scripture. All three of these are modeled for us by the New Testament writers. Now, with that, here's what's important to know. Jesus can't say, "Remember Lot's wife," without a Lot's wife as an example, right? It's all born out of the literal sense of the text, is what I'm saying. Lot's wife really existed. And because Lot's wife really existed, Jesus can say, "Remember Lot's wife." Abraham really existed, and because Abraham really existed, he can say, "Look forward to a new city." Right? Israel really existed, and because Israel really existed, he can say, "Trust in Jesus, the new and better Israel." Okay, let's look at some examples. I want to start in the category of faith. Okay, so the category of faith, let's remember 2 Timothy 3:16. The Old Testament is able to make you wise for salvation through Christ. It's able to give you faith in Christ. You're able to be born again from the Old Testament, which means that Christ must be present in the Old Testament in some way. And we need to be able to read the Old Testament in a way which gives us faith in Christ. And I think that that is the typological reading of Scripture. The typological reading of Scripture, or the reading of Scripture which produces faith. The reading of Scripture which produces faith. Old Testament texts are meant to produce faith in Christ. In fact, we saw this earlier, Paul's condemnation of the Jews in Romans 9:32 is that they did not pursue the Old Testament as though it were about faith in Christ. Rather, they pursued it as though it were about works. So Christ is in the Old Testament, and the Old Testament is able to make us wise to salvation. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 10, verse 4. They all drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. There's two strange things here. There's two strange things that Paul is seeing in the rock. Can you think of what they are? Two things that rocks aren't or rocks don't do. Yeah, Abel. Yeah, the rock was Christ, right? It doesn't seem like it. It doesn't seem like the rock is Christ. What's the second odd thing? Yeah, it followed them. The rock followed them. I don't remember a rock following Israel through the wilderness. Do you? There was no like rolling rock that was just kind of like going on. Maybe in the front you have God and the pillar of smoke and the pillar of fire, and that's in front, and then behind is this rock that's Jesus just kind of rolling. That didn't happen in the text. But, you know, rocks do show up several times in the text. Rocks do show up several times in the text. The first one is Exodus 17, verse 6. This is probably what he has in mind, right? So in Exodus 17, here's what happens. Remember, this is the text in which God brings Israel out of Egypt. And as he brings them out of Egypt, the people complain and they say, God, you brought us out here to kill us. That's their complaint. You brought us out here to kill us. Now look at what happens here. God tells Moses to strike the rock, and the water will come out of it. Now, I would like to argue that in the Old Testament text itself, it gives us the ability to think of this rock as Christ already. Look at verse 6. Is there anything in verse 6 that would make you think that Paul maybe wasn't just allegorizing, but something, there's something there in the literal sense of the text? Yeah, they drank. What happens before that? What's the very beginning of verse 6? God's standing on the rock. God is standing on the rock, okay? So if you think about it, God is on top of the rock that Moses is going to strike. So if you're visualizing it that way, you can't help but think that Moses is striking God, right? If God's on the rock and Moses is striking the rock, well, while certainly Moses is striking the rock primarily, you can say in a sense Moses is striking God because God's on the rock. Okay, let's keep thinking about this, okay? Now, verse 7, what's the result? The result of the striking is God is really among them, right? It proved that God was actually among his people. Now, read in light of Paul's interpretation, you could say he was personally among them in Christ, because Christ was that rock. There's more that we need to say here, though. I do think the literal sense of the text points us to this. So spiritually, I think Israel, here's what happened. Israel receives waters of life from the rock that was struck, the rock upon which Yahweh himself stood. As the rock upon which Yahweh stood is struck, Israel receives life. Now, let's look at Psalm 78. As Psalm 78 interprets this story for us. Look at verse 20. Moses struck the rock, so the water gushed out. The streams overflowed. Can he also give bread for his people? Now look at verse 35. In the context of that story, they remembered, Israel remembered, that their rock was God. Here's what I think. I do think that in the minds of even the original readers, there's a sense in which they're beginning to equate Yahweh in the rock, so that the rock wasn't what gave them water. Yahweh gave them water. Okay, so the first odd thing was that rock was Christ. The other odd thing is that the rock followed them, right? The rock followed them. So there's three stories of rocks. There's three stories of rocks in Israel's journey through the wilderness, okay? The first one is when the rock was struck, and that rock was Christ. Now, the other story is Numbers 20, verse 11. Do you remember this? This is when Moses lifted up his rod, and he struck the rock twice. And because he struck the rock twice, he couldn't go in the promised land. Isn't that a little petty, God? He didn't worship the golden calf. He didn't go into the promised land and refuse to go in. No, he took the rod and struck the rock twice, and so now he can't go into the promised land. That seems a little harsh, don't you think? Why? Why in the world would God care that much about how many times Moses hit the rock? Well, in this text, so Moses, let's think about it, Moses is angry with the people for complaining. And he strikes the rock in his wrath. And water pours out. He strikes it twice, right? The rock, you can even say this. Who is Moses angry with? Is Moses angry with the rock? No. Moses is angry with the people. The people are the ones he's angry with, but he strikes the rock. The rock, then, in this text, takes the blow of wrath towards the people upon itself. Read in light of Paul's, this rock was Christ. Why was it so important that Moses hit the rock once? Because Christ was struck once for sins. And the rod of God's judgment will not fall upon Christ twice. This is what's being said. Moses, don't mess with my typology. That rock is Christ. And if you hit that rock twice, you can't go into the promised land because that messes with the typology. That messes with the pattern that will show people how to have faith in Christ. There's one other rock text, though. Exodus 33, 18 through 23. Moses said, "Show me your glory." And he said, "I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. I will show mercy to whom I will show mercy." But he said, "You cannot see my face, for man shall not see my face and live." And the Lord said, "Behold, there is a place by me. It's next to me. It's with me. There's a place by me where you shall stand on the rock and where my glory will pass. And I will put you in the cleft of the rock. And I will cover you with my hand until I pass by. So Moses requires, Moses requests that he would see Yahweh, but Yahweh says, you can't see me and live. And what's the solution? The solution is to hide Moses in this rock, so that as Yahweh passes by, he would not be struck dead from the presence of God. The mediator stands between Moses and God, and that rock was Christ. So the Psalm 18 is true. The Lord is my rock in whom I take refuge. I think that's what Paul is doing. I think Paul is seeing this pattern of this rock showing up. And as this rock is showing up, it's either taking wrath, or this rock is standing between God and Moses. And Moses hides in it, and as he does, he finds safety. And maybe even John has this in mind. As Christ is killed on the cross, his side is pierced, and water mixed with blood flows out of the side of Christ. Let's look at another text, though. Let's look at a harder one. Galatians 4, 27 through 31. Turn there. Is Paul just doing some strange allegory that's not born out of any literal sense of the text? Paul's just, what are you doing, Paul? Does Paul have something else in mind? I want you to look at this. Galatians 4, 21 through 31. What is Paul doing? And is it born in the literal sense of the text at all? Okay, I want you to imagine I stand up on Sunday morning, and here's what I do. I read the story of, I'm preaching the story of Hagar, right, and Sarah. And I get to the point where Sarah says, cast out the slave woman, right? Sarah says, cast Hagar out. Get rid of Hagar. And this is my main application of the text. Get rid of the false teachers. Cast out the slave woman. That's what Paul does, right? He hears the words of Sarah, cast out the slave woman, and he says, from that, cast out the false teachers who are causing you to return to the old covenant. Has Paul left the literal sense of the text? Is he just doing something? So here's a few options. Option number one, Paul is just doing something only he as an apostle is allowed to do. Right? He's allowed to do this, but we're not allowed to do this. Because if we do this, then we're allegorizing. But Paul was under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and so he is allowed to do it. That's one option. The other option is maybe there's more to what Paul is doing than meets the eye. And we'll come back and we'll examine the Hagar-Sarah story and try to understand what Paul is doing with this text. Okay.